we're all so proud to be living in this great digital information age, yet at the same time, we can't manage our data. We're overwhelmed, we're drowning in it. There's a group of scientists at USC that try to figure out exactly how much data we face every day. So I know this is a dated study, but it gives us a sense of what we're dealing with here. So they found that we each receive about 174 newspapers worth of information every day. And I'm thinking that you guys might be saying, well, that's a lot. We're only human. We can't possibly process that kind of information. It couldn't be further from the truth. I want to tell you about the hidden superpowers that we have in all of our brains. We could process a lot more than that, and with ease, and it would be a lot of fun. So our brains are constantly sensing everything that's around us. Think about when you walk down a busy street, how aware you are of everything around you, without even thinking, without even trying, and how quickly you can pick out exactly what interests you. That's our superpowers in action. If you think about the connection between our eyes and the brain, it's on the order of magnitude of an Ethernet connection. If you take a truckload full of books and upload them at 10 megabits per second, it would only take 22 minutes to upload that information at this rate. And we're struggling with 174 newspapers over a span of a whole day. So we're not anywhere near using our theoretical capacity of the brain. And the reason for that is the way that the information is organized and presented to us. This picture, as they say, speaks a thousand words. This is our problem. We're shooting ourselves in the foot. We're stuck in this legacy organization system from 1864. And what we need is a complete paradigm shift of how we think about our information. Imagine waking up and on your bedroom walls, you have news feeds of the top stories, sports section, market information. With a gesture of your hand, you control the volume, you bring things closer to you, you open up an article, you go about your day, you go to the kitchen, on the walls there, there's more stories to be seen, and by the time you're ready to head to the office, you've processed a ton of information. You already know what's going on, and it was effortless and natural. And think also about all the video archives out there and the magazines that we could enjoy this way. Also, let's think about how we could create content in this format. Say we're planning a family vacation. We gather everybody in the family room. We're picking out things that people want to do and stuff that they want to go to and see. And everybody's waving their hands. We have the itinerary all picked out. And once we pick out the itinerary, we go on the vacation, we come back, suddenly there are a lot of pictures to organize and videos and memories. It's back to the family room for a scrapbook night. We go through all that and we set up our scrapbook this way, and we have our scrapbook and our vacation on our walls. We package that, we save that data in this format, we send it out to our friends, to grandma. Grandma can now take this and upload it and project it onto the walls of her own house and be completely immersed in our adventure. This is my vision for how we should be handling data. What this vision addresses that our status quo system does not is that it organizes the data spatially, and it has a lot of visuals. So not everything is visual, but there are visual cues that go with the information so that our brains can pick out and sense what's important. And if you think back to our ancestors, they were hunters and gatherers. Our brains are wired to process a lot of visual information. Our ancestors were looking for food and predators, and they were running around the wild. That's what we still have in our DNA, and that's what we have to take advantage of to get to the superpowers that we all have. the memory champions who are very good at memorizing things use this technique. What they do is they imagine a place that they go to inside their heads. It could be a home or something else. And they associate a visual cue with each fact they're trying to remember. And they walk around that space and deposit these visual cues throughout the space. And then when they need to recall it, it's fairly easy. And this technique improves recall rates tremendously. So this, what we're trying to do is figure out a way to convert our data into this format. And we've developed a tool that runs on a website that allows people to build their own memory palaces and express their ideas and projects this way. And so here's the tool in action. And we can communicate by sending these memory palaces to each other. And this is how we can share our information. And any gamer out there will tell you how much fun it is to immerse yourself in a space like this, even if it is on a flat screen. And I approached the WHITEHEAD Institute. And the WHITEHEAD Institute is one of the a top research institute in life sciences in the world with this idea. And this is how they're pioneering the use of this tool.
Our primary objective being to introduce this nonprofit to brand new constituencies. We've used this tool to divide the introduction to WHITEHEAD Institute into three distinct sections or rooms. As you can see here, this is the first room, and what we've done is introduce WHITEHEAD Institute's founder, Jack WHITEHEAD, and also presented a video on the early days of the organization.
Small institutions work better from a cultural point of view, scientific cultural point of view.
In the second room seen here, we track the organization's road to success and map its major achievements and biomedical breakthroughs over its 30-year history. And lastly, in the third room seen here, we present WHITEHEAD Institute as it is today and introduce its current researchers, as well as their efforts to both understand and cure devastating human diseases.
So once we have the data in this format, if we wanted to get human scale, which is how we naturally relate the things, we would need the use of these components. And for it to become ubiquitous and for everybody to be a part of the system, they have to get cheap enough for all of us to use them and have them. And I'm confident that's going to happen in the next few years, that we could have, we would have the ability to have these experiences inside our homes and offices. Now, the issue is, what happens when we're on the go? How do we immerse ourselves in our data? Well, I was thinking that those phone booths could be really our answer to the future. We can go in, plug in our smartphone, and suddenly be immersed in our data. So think about the productivity and the collective intellect of the human race, how that could be impacted if we could experience our data this way. Think about 174 newspapers that we started with. We could digest that for breakfast. Think about how much more effectively and efficiently we could learn, collaborate, innovate, all the ideas that we could realize this way. And finally, liberate ourselves from the entrapment of the system from 1864. And one final thing to leave you with. What if eventually there is no need for projections and walls, and maybe there's a way that we can more directly get these images into our brains? Super brains. Thank you.